To start the book of Daniel, chapter 8. We are still in what could be called the apocalyptic section of Daniel, which means we're looking at figures of speech, figurative language. It's intentionally written to where their enemies don't know what is being said. It's just that way all the way through. And so we look at Daniel chapter 8. It's another vision, different from, we've already seen Nebuchadnezzar's vision in 2 and in 4, and now Daniel's vision in 7, and this is a new vision in chapter 8 that we're looking at now. So listen to what he has to say. In the third year of the reign of King Belshazzar, a vision appeared to me, Daniel, after the one that appeared to me the first time. I saw in the vision, and it so happened, while I was looking, that I was in Shushan, the citadel, which is in the province of Elam. And I saw in the vision that I was by the river Ulai. All right, the timing is laid out here. The vision came during Belshazzar's reign as co-regent with Nabonidus. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? We've bumped into that a little bit before. These two reigned together. Nabonidus is really the king. But he, to the way we can see it historically, he never lived in Babylon. He never lived there. And the reason he didn't is for multiple reasons. One is he was often leading them in battle. That's one aspect of it. But the other aspect is that he had some viewpoints, probably of a religious nature, that were not palatable to the people in Babylon. So he just didn't live there. Son did. And so we most often call him a co-regent, that he ruled with his dad, and he was the primary in the city, as it's described here, Shushan, the citadel, the capital city. Third year of Belshazzar's reign, it came before Daniel 5, but after Daniel 7. I'm telling you, you really need to lay out a chronology of the book of Daniel, because it doesn't go the way you think it will. So we've already seen that Belshazzar dies in chapter 5. So both these visions, the first one and now this one, predate the death of Belshazzar. So that's what he's told us. In the vision, Daniel was in Susa, likely the capital city of Babylon. Why do I say likely? We're not dead sure. That's the easiest answer to that. It sounds like that it's the capital. The Ulai was apparently a large artificial canal, about 900 feet in breadth, which connected two other rivers, the Chospis and the Cuprates, and passed by Susa on the northeast. So an artificial river. What can you think of anything that might be in our era an artificial river or like an artificial river? Would you say Suez Canal? Yeah, sure. Suez Canal's one, and is, once you're on that road, you're supposed to say Panama Canal. Because both of them are built the same way. They're artificial. They were not there. Both of them were designed to cut across short spaces. I think Suez may be longer than Panama, but nonetheless, short spaces so you can get between two big bodies of water, and they go through a series of locks. That's not the case here, but it's similar. It's a similar idea. Oh, the Erie Canal. Well, and you got the same thing. That's up in New York, Pennsylvania, up in that area. Yes, similar. So these are artificial bodies of water, rivers, or if you can make an artificial river, that's what you've got. All right, verses 3 and 4. Then I lifted my eyes and saw, and there standing beside the river was a ram which had two horns, and the two horns were high, but one was higher than the other, and the higher one came up last. I saw the ram pushing westward, northward, and southward, so that no animal could withstand him, nor was there any that could deliver from his hand. But he did according to his will and became great. All right. As we will see as we make our way through this, we're talking about nations. And this first nation, it's very, very apparent, is the nation of Medo-Persia. That's the one that's coming in here. And we want to see that. A ram with two horns, one higher than the other, which may indicate one side having greater strength than the other. Sorry about that. Okay. The ram is pictured as originating in the east and proceeding outward in an unstoppable manner toward the other three cardinal directions. So you think about the area of the world that we're in. East is not toward the Mediterranean. It's the other way. So if you're looking at Israel, if you were looking at a map and you had Egypt on your western side, then you're looking up to the east and shade north as well, because you, from Israel, you can't go anywhere but either north or south for the most part, and then you swing around. It's in kind of a hook, like a quarter moon, something long about like that is what you're talking about. So he's looking there, and that's this great nation, and it's conquering. It's evident it's conquering. It goes anywhere it wants to go, and it conquers a lot of places. Among those will be Babylon itself. You know, it's going to be conquered by Medo-Persian Empire. All right, pick up verse 5 then. And as I was considering, suddenly a male goat came from the west across the surface of the whole earth, without touching the ground, and the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. Then he came to the ram that had two horns, which I had seen standing beside the river, and ran at him with furious power. And I saw him confronting the ram. He was moved with rage against him, attacked the ram, and broke his two horns. There was no power in the ram to withstand him. But he cast him down to the ground and trampled him, and there was no one that could deliver the ram from his hand. Therefore, the male goat grew very great. But when he became strong, the large horn was broken, and in place of it, four notable ones came up toward the four winds of heaven. All right, what are we talking about? Let's begin with, here's Daniel, and he's just seen this ram. And if you saw this, what would you do? Well, I suspect I'd be thinking, wonder what that means. And that's what he's doing. He's contemplating this. He's thinking about it. But in the midst of his thought process, he now sees a goat. Now, this goat can fly. And when you look at the way it's written, he doesn't ever touch the ground. He flies. He moves so fast that his feet never touch the ground. And this ram has only one horn, a big, notable horn that is in the middle of the ram. It came from the west. All right, now if you're up, like we're talking about up in Assyria, up in that area. Okay, now go across the map. What's to the west? Greece. Now, a little background. We mentioned it a little bit last week. I'll remind everybody of it, and some that may not have been here will tell it for the first time. The Medo-Persian Empire had done everything it could to defeat Macedonia. And the head of Macedonia, which of course is a part of Greece, the head of Macedonia was Philip of Macedon. Now, Philip of Macedon is the father of Alexander the Great. So they kept pounding away and pounding away and pounding away, trying to defeat Philip of Macedon, in a certain sense, defeat Greece. That's what their goal is. They never succeeded and never completely conquered them, harassed them, troubled them, gave them difficult days, but never defeated them. So when you see this image, my suspicion is that's the best way to describe the fast-moving anger of Alexander the Great. He is going to avenge his dad and what has happened to him. It is fast, not touching the ground. Reminds us of the third beast in Daniel chapter 7. Now remember, in Daniel 7, we've got Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. So the third beast in that vision would be Greece. Again, same nation as it is here. The goat charged the ram with wrath, defeating and trampling it. The Greeks were angry because multiple attempted invasions of their territory. They would break Medo-Persian power. That's what their goal was, and that's what they did. They smashed their power. So really, the imagery that God gives is pretty good. But now, I've got a question for you. In relation to Daniel, when did this happen? Well, approximately, when was Jerusalem conquered? The first time. That's the ultimate, 589. The first time was in like 605. That's probably when Daniel was taken. Near as we can tell, that's when Daniel was taken. So if Daniel lived to be 100 years old, it's still 505. When is Alexander the Great? Almost 200 full years later. So do you understand why liberal scholars who do not believe in predictive prophecy, do you understand why they have got to move Daniel down? They've got to take the book and move it down. It's going to get worse. It's not going to get better. Because when we get in chapters 10 and 11, especially 11, he's going to be talking about events that happened in like 180, 150. And he gives details that are unbelievable. They're that thorough. It's almost like writing a newspaper article about what's going to happen, but it's still, 350, 400 years later before it's going to happen. So you can see why that they're disturbed by this chapter. Just wait till they get to 11. They just about go nuts, when they get to 11. So if you're reading a commentary, and I don't have any problem reading a commentary, but if you're reading one and they go down that road and say, now Daniel could not have been written until, then you already know. You know what you're dealing with. So you can't trust everything they say. Some of their history is good, because they'll report on the history and they'll say, see, you had to live after that to write like this. That's their argument. But no, if you're inspired, you don't have to live after. God just lets you know. He informs you. And so, all right. So then, we got four horns that arose. We already read a little bit about that. The big horn is broken. Now, the four horns, quite interesting if you study this historically. It took 20 years plus for Greece to settle out who's going to lead them after the death of Alexander the Great. There were wars. Several people died that were in leadership positions. They were killed. One was put in a position of authority, and he was wiped out. They just turned on him. One fellow was put in a position of power. His name is Ptolemy. Ptolemy was put in power down around Egypt, and really, he didn't start out in the high position, but he ends up there. In fact, ultimately, Ptolemy and the Seleucids, that's what's left. Those two are the big fighters in the whole thing. But there, it does, when it shakes out after about 20 years, there are four who have taken over for the one horn for Alexander the Great. Nobody had the same type of power that Alexander had. So let's read a little bit more now about these four notable horns. And out of them came a little horn which grew exceedingly great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the glorious land. The glorious land? What's the glorious land? Yeah, Canaan or Israel. Yeah, it's Israel. We sing a song. Well, I don't know. I don't remember whether we sing it here or not. Some of you will know it. Drew probably knows it. I just don't know if we sing it. I don't remember. But, oh, Beulah land, sweet Beulah land. That's this, the beautiful land. Beulah land. That's what we're talking about. It's Israel. And so this notable horn is going to give fits to the beautiful land. So who is the little horn that gives fits to the beautiful land, to Israel? And remember now, they're going to, before this happens, Israel is restored, right? Cyrus comes along at the fall of Babylon, and Cyrus releases them. In fact, those are the last words pretty much of the book of Second Chronicles. He gives a decree, you can go home. And the books of Ezra and Nehemiah cover that material, at least somewhat. So they're home. But boy, do they ever get tormented. They get tormented by a little horn, as described here. And as we go along in chapter 11, particularly, we're going to see the little horn detailed out quite significantly. His name is Antiochus, and he calls himself Epiphanes, which basically means he thinks he's a god. And if you don't believe that, just study historically. By the time you arrive at the life of Christ, there are 11 Antiochs in the world, all of them named for this guy, the little horn, every one of them. So in order to identify them, you've got to tell where they are. Now, by the way, sometimes driving through Mississippi, I am struck by the fact that you've got to know what state you're in. You know, because you've got, Louisville? That doesn't sound like Mississippi. It sounds like Kentucky to me. And keep going. You've got many, many more, right? By the way, that's true. Lots of places. Tennessee and Texas have a lot in common that they share. Why? Well, Texas is basically settled by a bunch of Tennesseans. You know, that's why. So they carry their names, you know, with them. But I want you to pick up on that. You have to identify. Where's Knoxville? Well, I'd say Tennessee, but you might say no, Mississippi. See, so that's the way that works. You know, so Antiochus, 11 places named for himself. So pick back up, verse 9. And out of one of them came a little horn which grew exceedingly great toward the south, toward the east, toward the glorious land. And it grew up to the host of heaven. And it cast down some of the host and some of the stars to the ground and trampled them. He even exalted himself as high as the prince of the host. And by him the daily sacrifices were taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down because of transgression. An army was given over to the horn to oppose the daily sacrifices, and he cast truth to the ground. He did all this and prospered. All right. Wayne Jackson, if you really want to enjoy studying in more depth the prophets, and I rarely ever say anything about books, but Wayne Jackson's commentary on the prophets is excellent. It's top of the line. And when I say the prophets, I mean all of them. All five major prophets and all 12 minor prophets are included. And Daniel being the last major prophet, by the way. Here's what Brother Jackson said about the verses we just read. Out of one of these four horns, there arose a little horn, not the same as the little horn in chapter 7, verse 8, which we talked about last week. The horn grew in power and exerted his malevolent influence, significantly including in Palestine, called the Glorious Land, verse 9. The invading movement was arrogant, perhaps signified by its self-exaltation to the host of heaven. The horn's self-aggrandizement, I don't use that word very often, can you tell? Even sought to rival the prince of the, that should be host. My spell checker does not believe that I mean host. Obviously, I meant hose, the great hose. Well, I have one of those at home, but that's not what we're talking about here. This is the great host, H-O-S-T. And I will speak to my typist about that later. But anyway, the horns, the prince of the host, commonly identified as God, thus nullifying the worship of him and destroying his temple, verse 11. As a result of their own sins, the Jews were given over to this ungodly force, and the cause of truth suffered considerably. All right, so we've got this little guy coming along that thinks he's God. We've already seen that, Antiochus Epiphanes. He's really Antiochus the Fourth. Calls himself Epiphanes, or God, if you want to put it, Glorious One is basically what it means. And he ends the temple worship. He destroys it. If you wonder why Herod had to build another temple after they built a temple in Ezra and Nehemiah, here's why. Because Antiochus Epiphanes destroyed it again. You know, wasn't even as good as Solomon's temple to begin with, but it was wiped out too by him. And he ended the daily sacrifice. Now, if you do some reading, like in the IVP Bible Background Commentary, you're going to find some interesting computation of numbers that you're going to see here as we go forward. They may be right. They may not be right. I can tell you that on this particular one, it sounds like they've at least got a reasonable argument. We'll talk more about this, getting into the numbers a little bit. So 13 and 14. Then I heard a holy one speaking, and another holy one said to that certain one who is speaking, how long will the vision be concerning the daily sacrifices and the transgression of desolation, the giving of both the sanctuary and the host to be trampled underfoot? And he said to me, for 2,300 days, then the sanctuary shall be cleansed. So 2,300 days, it'd take me a little bit to calculate that one out. I forget the exact number of days, but it's going to go a period of time. Daniel overheard the holy ones, probably angels, discussing the sanctuary, that we'd say the temple, the cessation of the burnt offering, the desolation of the sanctuary. Daniel was told the sanctuary would be restored in 2,300 evenings and mornings. With all the figurative language, it seems unlikely that this is a literal time. That's why I get a little fascinated when somebody tries to give you their rationale for how it ends up a certain place, because this is figurative language. It's kind of like going to Revelation chapter 20 and reading about the 1,000 years and then saying, see there? And all of a sudden, have you ever noticed this? Everything else in that chapter is figurative, and they'll tell you it is, but the 1,000 years is literal. How did it get to be that way? That's not typical. When you're talking about figurative language, it's usually all figurative, not a spot here or there where there's literal stuff. And so I've got my doubts. What it is, though, is it the time between the overthrow and the reestablishment of temple worship. By the time Jesus comes, temple worship's back in force. They're back worshiping there. Herod has built his temple. You may remember a discussion that Jesus had. I believe it's recorded in John chapter 2. where he says, destroy this temple, in 3 days I'll raise it up. And they said, it took 40 years to build this place, and you're going to raise it up in 3 days? Well, you will notice an interesting little point that's made there. John says, after he's raised from the dead, they remembered this. And what was their conclusion? He's talking about his body. He wasn't talking about a physical earthly building. He was talking about his temple, his body. That's what he was talking about. The word remembered is key because the Holy Spirit is supposed to remind them of all things. And this is one case where he does do that. Pick up verse 15 then. Then it happened, when I, Daniel, had seen the vision and was seeking the meaning, that suddenly there stood before me one having the appearance of a man. He's seeking the meaning. What might this mean? How might he have sought the meaning? And I'm going to give you my guess, and please notice I was careful to say it that way. He prayed 3 times a day. So if I really wanted to know the meaning and I was as prayerful as Daniel was, I think I'd ask God. And if you listen to the way that the angel responds, I think that's probably what happened. But I keep emphasizing, watch my words. I'm using flag words all over the place. I think it might. Those kind of things. I can't prove this. I'm just telling you what I think it is. Okay? And I heard a man's voice between the banks of the Ulai who called and said, Gabriel, make this man understand the vision. So he came near where I stood, and when he came, I was afraid and fell on my face. But he said to me, understand, son of man, that the vision refers to the time of the end. Gabriel, the archangel, was sent by God to interpret the vision for Daniel. By the way, to my knowledge, there are only 2 angels named in all of Scripture by name. One is Gabriel, and you're going to see him again. Did anybody remember where you see him? Besides in Daniel, by the way. Doesn't he visit Mary? Isn't that right? Luke chapter 2, I believe. Luke chapter 1, excuse me. Luke 1, he visits Mary. So, you know, all of a sudden you see him again. The other one is Michael. And Michael is mentioned as well, seemingly another archangel. Now, again, notice my words. I'm being careful here with these things. His appearance was like a man. He also appears in Daniel 9 and in Luke 1, verse 19 and 1:26. Daniel fell prostrate as he was frightened by Gabriel's appearance. The vision is for the time of the end. In context, it seems to be the time of the end of the desecration of the sanctuary during the intertestamental period. There's more than one end in Scripture. It's not always the end of time where it's going to be judgment and so forth. It's not always that. And here, if you stay within the context, then I'm suggesting it probably refers to when this temple sacrifices begin again. So you're right about the time Jesus is going to come to earth, which significantly is also right about the time of the end of the Jewish system. You see where those two may go together? I didn't say they do, but I'd say they might. It does seem possible. So we've looked at that. Verses 18 and following. Now, as he was speaking with me, I was in a deep sleep with my face to the ground. But he touched me and stood me upright. And he said, look, I'm making known to you what shall happen in the latter time of the indignation. For at the appointed time, the end shall be. The ram which you saw, having the 2 horns, they are the kings of Media and Persia. One rule of biblical interpretation when you talk about figurative language: when God tells you what it means, there's no more question. Who does God say that the ram is? Media Persia. 2 horns? Media Persia. That's what we're looking at. So he's very, very clear about that. Daniel may have passed out from the strain. He's face down in the ground. Did he pass out? I don't know. Possibility that he did. Daniel was revived and helped to stand upright by, of all people, Gabriel, by the angel. Indignation here is a technical term for designating the wrath of God and his displeasure. God's displeased with his people. They give up idolatry. When they come out of Babylon, you never see idolatry again. Not with the Jews. You may see it in other places, but you don't see it with the Jews. But what else do you see from the Jews? They don't have a heart for God. Look at the book of Malachi. He just rips them because of their heart. He basically said, they're not interested in your sacrifices. Why? They don't have the right heart for it. And so the few prophets that write after they've returned seem to indicate to the people, you're not finished yet. You got to keep growing. You got to keep developing. And God is full of wrath at them. Isaiah 10:5, 10:25, and 26:20 all talk about the wrath of God, indignation, same idea. Gabriel identified the ram as the kings of Media and Persia. All right, so Alexander the Great sought to Hellenize the East. Many young Jews, even priests, were influenced to accept Greek customs and follow their religion. The result was corruption of morals and transgressions of the law. Trying to be delicate here, but not much way to be totally delicate. The Greeks practiced their athletic endeavors with no clothes on. Now, how do you think that went over God? Here's the God that made clothing for Adam and Eve, right? He made sure it covered them thoroughly. They'd made clever covers of leaves. God didn't care for that. He wanted something that covered them better. The Greeks come along, and as they Hellenize the Jewish people, then they begin to adopt these customs. And you can see why God is going to become very, very angry with them. Ultimately, God's wrath came upon his people. Okay, look at verse 21 as we continue. And the male goat is the kingdom of Greece. The large horn that's between its eyes is the first king. Well, Philip of Macedon was the first king of Macedonia, but Alexander was the first in order of preeminence. Watch your biblical words. Paul says, I am the chief of sinners. You can literally translate that first. And what he's saying is, I'm preeminent. That's something else, isn't it? Shining number one, but I'm number one in sin. That's basically what Paul said when he wrote that. Well, here you're seeing Alexander as the preeminent king of Greece. Philip of Macedon was king, true. But he was not anywhere like Alexander. Alexander was much greater in his power. He became king at the age of 20, 336 B.C., He conquered Syria, Egypt, Persia, Media, and India. To consolidate his empire, he tried to develop a common way of life by introducing Greek culture, and language became nearly universal. And brethren, I'm going to tell you something. God was at work through Alexander the Great. Why? Why do you say that, Gary? Because Koine Greek is one of the most explicit languages ever written. It has all kinds of special nuances that are in the middle of it. For example, I'm going to pick on Christian for a minute. If you were to meet with Christian one day, you might say, you know what? I love hamburgers. I just love hamburgers. On another day, you might say, well, what do you think of Christine? He says, well, I just love Christine. Now, which one's which? What's the difference? In English, there's no difference. I mean, I know there's a difference with Christian. I've seen it, okay? So I'm not making fun of him, but you get the point. In English, you can't tell. In Greek, it's easy, because Koine Greek has four languages for love. Eros, never used in Scripture. It's the word we get our erotic out of. Storge, that's fleshly love. It's used twice, but both times in the negative, not in the affirmative. And that's fleshly love. It's the mother of a love of a mother for her child, for example. And then you got phileo. We got our city of Philadelphia. That's brotherly love. And then you've got agapao, or agape, and that is total devoted love. You cannot sway devoted love. You may hurt it, you may torture it, and so forth, but you can never make it give up. On occasion, you know, your children may say to you, I know mine have, there's no way you can love, you should be thinking that much about me or worried that much about me. And I say, you can't stop me from loving you. That's not going to happen. It's just not going to happen. Now, am I going to be happy with everything to do? What do you think, Tim? I doubt it. I doubt it. But I love them anyway. That's what you do. So anyway, that's the devoted type of love. He founded Greek cities and colonies. Think about Alexandria and Egypt, where they translated the Hebrew scriptures into Greek, called the Septuagint. He died in 323 B.C. at the age of 33. Didn't live very long, did he? Okay, so that's who we're talking about. Verse 22. As for the broken horn, the four that stood up in his place, four kingdoms shall rise out of that nation, but not with its power. Alexander's death brought chaos. Leadership was divided among four generals called the Didakoi, or successors. A continual struggle arose between the Seleucid and the Ptolemaic Empire. Seleucid is up around Syria, that area, and the Ptolemaic is in Egypt. Palestine was right in between the two, and thus a logical target for fighting for control. They go through Israel all the time, one way and the other. Whichever one's in power, they trample through Israel every time. Palestine fell into Syrian hands, that's Seleucid hands, in 198 B.C. They tried to force them to accept Hellenism. Persecution led to the Maccabean Revolt. And while I do not believe that First Maccabees is canonical, I believe it's pretty good history. If you want to read it for history, it's worthwhile. It's pretty good for that particular point. Verse 23 and following. In the latter time of their kingdom, when the transgressors have reached their fullness, a king shall arise, having fierce features, who understands sinister schemes. His power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. He shall destroy fearfully, and shall prosper and thrive, and shall destroy the mighty and also the holy people. Through his cunning, he shall cause deceit to prosper under his rule, and he shall exalt himself in his heart. He shall destroy many in their prosperity. He shall even rise against the prince of princes, but he shall be broken without human means. And the vision of the evenings and the mornings, which was told, is true. Therefore, seal up the vision, for it refers to many days in the future. In other words, don't go out and publish the newspaper yet. It's not time. But this is what's going to happen. So what have we got? Antiochus Epiphanes IV appears to be the little horn. He ruled the Seleucid dynasty from 175 to 163 B.C. He named himself Epiphanes, glorious, manifest, or splendid. He sold the high priesthood to the highest bidder, appointing Jason, a proponent of Hellenism, to be the high priest. So in other words, high priesthood went to pot at that particular point in time. He built a gymnasium in Jerusalem where Jewish youths exercised naked, which was Greek custom. Greek names were adopted in place of traditional Jewish names. And if you want to see something significant, read Acts chapter 6. When you got the Hellenistic problem that comes along, every name of every man that's chosen to serve tables is Hellenized. Every one of them. Now, why is that important? Well, if you got a problem, If a certain group of people have a problem, if possible, appoint folks within their midst to be the leaders. They won't challenge them. They'll accept that they're looking out for their best interests. It's one of the smartest things that you'll ever see. Of course, the apostles and ultimately then God had something to do with it. He changed worship. He ordered worship of Greek deities. He had drunken orgies to Bacchus, which were mandatory. Bacchus is the god of wine, by the way. Under penalty of death, he forbade circumcision, Sabbath, and feast observances. Jewish scriptures, he ordered copies destroyed. He set up an image of Zeus and had pigs sacrificed on the altar of God. Talk about desecration. That, in the Jewish mind, would have been totally desecration. So watch verse 27. And I, Daniel, fainted and was sick for days. Afterward, I rose and went about the king's business. I was astonished by the vision, but no one understood it. Okay, the temple, I should go on to say, was restored by Judas Maccabeus in December 165 BC. The vision of the future of God's people had a physical impact on Daniel. You see it. It just totally impacted him. Verse 28 reports the impact of the visions on Daniel. His thoughts alarmed him. He turned pale. He kept the matter in his heart or to himself. That's New American Standard Bible that translated that way. Questions about chapter 8 of the book of Daniel. Okay, so 7 and 8 are a prelude. They're setting the stage. 9 is going to be Daniel's reaction to reading Scripture. And it's evident he read Scripture very thoroughly. We'll see that, Lord willing, next week when he tells us why it is that he prayed to God. And he's got a very good reason for it that we want to look at. Chapters 10 and 11 are a great elaboration on the last part of this chapter that we just went through. Tremendous elaboration. We're going to learn about Cleopatra, and all you're going to say, I know Cleopatra, Mark Anthony. No. There are a number, I think it's 15, but I need to double check, Cleopatras. The one you're thinking about was Cleopatra, but it's not the Cleopatra of Scripture. And we're going to talk about her. And she's quite interesting. She's married off, and we'll see that when we get to chapters 10 and 11. She's married off because her daddy wants to spy in the camp of the other king. Problem is, she decided to go with her husband. And so dad doesn't get what he wants. See, that's the way that works out. And brethren, please, if you want to check this out, historically, it's to a T right. There's not a mistake in here. Now, I'll grant you that some things I have to say to you, I'm not sure about this, but I know enough about the overview, the whole thing, that I know God didn't miss a beat. It's all correct, every bit of it. Powerful, powerful testimony to the inspiration of Scripture, therefore a defeat to the liberal scholars, and they know it. Thank you. Thank you.
going to go ahead and get started with our midweek service. Got a few announcements we'll make. Former member Donna Taylor has breast cancer and is scheduled for surgery on April the 23rd. Please keep Beth Pig in your prayers. She is dealing with a bad infection, and Miss Teresa has been in the hospital a few days this week. Some of us may have been aware of that. She has come home today, so we're grateful for that. Continue to keep Lana Clark, Bob, Mary Ellen, and let's say Paul and Joanne as well, those that are not doing good. Mystery Fellowship this Friday night, April the 5th at 6:30 p.m. If you have not been given your assignment, see Derek and him. All ladies are invited to a baby shower honoring Shelby and Kyle Russell on April the 7th at 3:30 to 5 p.m. in the downstairs fellowship hall. They are registered at Baby List. Standing in the Gap and Women of the Word will meet on April the 8th at 6:30. A fellowship meal and a last of leaders recognition will be April the 14th. Everyone is asked to bring potluck, drinks, and desserts. We will be honoring all the children, all the young people that participated in last of leaders. Ladies' Day, April the 20th, the guest speaker is April Britton. Please sign up in the foyer if you would like to help with this Ladies' Day. Also, the church that we had it placed out back on the asphalt by the gym back there. And let's be aware that this is for events here at the church and not for personal use. It can get filled up pretty quick. It's not a big dumpster, but it's big enough for our use. So we ask that when events are taking place, we all do a better job of cleaning up, making sure everything is ready to go for the next activity. We have a nice facility here and we want to be able to take care of it. So I know Derek's going to get with the people that are over like baby showers and events and things that are going on here at the church other than Wednesday and Sunday so that we make sure we're getting the trash out of the church. I know some of you, like myself, have come up the steps and you smell the trash, or you go in the back and you smell the trash. So this gives us an opportunity to use this to be able to get it out of the building, hold down situations like that, and rodents as well. So, I mean, when you put things like that in the building, we could have issues with that. So let's keep in mind to keep things cleaned up. And like I said, it's out back here, and you'll be able to see it and use it, you know, for the events that you do here at the building. So as we begin our period of worship this evening, let's go to our Father in prayer. God, we love you, and we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time that we had in Bible study this evening. We're grateful that we have classes like this in our midweek that we can come together as your children and to open your word and to be able to dig deeper into it, have more time to study it, to be able to learn it, gain the knowledge from it, to live our lives more obedient to you and to be able to teach others and gain others the knowledge that we are able to present them, and that they too may know your word, and that more souls can be brought to you from being able to have times like this that we can study, Lord. We are grateful for those that presented lessons. They take time to study, to bring the lessons to us in a way that we can use them and are presented in a way that we can understand them, and we're grateful for them. We're thankful for Sidewell Road and what it means to each one of us. We're thankful for the church here that is able to do things to spread your word throughout our community, throughout this country, and throughout the world through the means that we have. We're grateful for those that work with us here and are able to bring the word to us, and for those that work with our youth group, those that work with the congregation here to try and get everyone involved in something that they are able to help and be involved with. We're grateful for those that help us do that. We're grateful for each member that we have here, and we ask that you bless us and continue to watch over us. And We're thankful for those that are here tonight. We ask that those that are not here and are able to understand that it is very important that we come together as a family each week and each Sunday as we worship you. We ask that you continue to be with those that I mentioned that were sick. We have a list in our bulletin each week that is more than just what I mentioned here tonight. And I ask that we pray for each one of these families and the individuals that could be in the hospitals, could be having surgeries or things going on in their life that are causing them an illness. And we ask that you continue to be with them and those that are tending their needs. We ask you to be with those that are shut in as well. Continue to be with those that have lost loved ones recently. We ask that you comfort them. We're thankful for this time that we have this evening together as your children. And as we lift up our prayers and as we lift up our voices in song, I pray that what we do is always acceptable in your sight and lifts us up so that we can continue to go through our week and let others know that we live a life that is different than theirs. And we let our light shine that those around us could see a difference in us, and hopefully that will open doors for us. We're thankful for Jesus and what he means to us. We're thankful for the cross that he bore for each one of us. Continue to be with us this week and let our light shine. It is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Opening song is 277.
Good evening.
Good evening.
277. We'll sing the first and third verse. First and third verse.
As I travel through this pilgrim land, there is a friend who walks with me. Leads me safely through the sinking sand. It is the Christ of Calvary. This would be my prayer, dear Lord, each day to help me do the best I can. For I need thy
Get your Bible this evening, please turn to 1 Peter
chapter 3, and we'll pick it up there in verse 13. We look at the context of this passage, it's talking a lot about suffering. And in fact, it starts off in verse 13, it says, "And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good?" Now, we know this question is followed up in verse, by this idea that even if you suffer, that's what the next verse says, "But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed, and do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled." Now, I want us to notice something here about this suffering that we are going to endure, that we're going to endure for righteousness' sake, that we're going to be blessed by as we endure. I want us to notice what verse 15 says, because verse 15 is going to help us to be ready to endure. It's going to be help us to ready to overcome and to last, to endure through this. But it's also going to take this idea of a defense, and it's going to put us also on the offensive, because there in verse 15 is, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts." So we see that this is one of the primary things it tells us to do in order to not only be pleasing to God, but to be ready for the suffering that's coming. We're going to sanctify the Lord God in our hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Now, when I first hear about that, and I think about, okay, I sanctify the Lord God in my heart, I have put into my heart the Word of God, I've allowed it to reside in me, I know it, which is what enables me to be able to give a defense. I usually thought about that intellectual knowledge or that study of God's Word, but I want us to not miss, as we continue on this passage, it's more than just study. It is more than just intellectual knowledge. It is a changing of life. It is a living of that life for God each and every day. Because it goes on, it says that, "I give a defense to everyone who asks for a reason for the hope that is in you." So obviously they notice something. But then it says in verse 16, "Having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. For it is better if it is the will of God to suffer for doing good than for doing evil." The whole context talks about suffering, and specifically suffering for doing good, suffering for righteousness. But I want us to notice in there, in order to help us in each day, to especially help us in our times of suffering, we are to sanctify the Word of God in our heart. We're to be ready to give a defense, which means we need to know it. We need to apply it. But we also need to see that we need to live it. That's how people are going to be able to see the hope that's in us. That's how we're going to fulfill the command where it says having a good conscience. Because our good conscience means that, you know what? I've lived that faithful life. I've taken what I've been taught, I've taken what I learned, and I put it into practice so that others may see the good works of me and glorify the Father which is in heaven. And so I just want to share this with us tonight, that suffering is going to come your way. But when it does, if you will have sanctified the Word of God in your heart, you're ready to give a defense, and you're living that good life for Him, then no matter what comes our way, we will be ready. And the even greater thing than that is, if we are ready, when Jesus comes back, we will have a home with Him in heaven. And so tonight, if there's anything we can do for you, whether prayers of the church, or tonight you're going to put on Christ in baptism, please come as we stand and as we sing.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No.
gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We're thankful for the opportunity that we've had today to be an example to the world. We pray that everything that we have done today has been in a manner in which we glorify your name and be the light unto the world that sorely needs it. We thank you so much for this church. We're thankful for every member that is here. We're thankful for the love that they have for you, and the desire that each one of us has to follow after the Lord's footsteps and do all that we can to do your will. We pray that you would be with each one of us tonight as we depart from this place. We ask that you would give us the strength and courage to look to your word daily, and so that we can learn who you are and grow closer to you, and that we can change our lives in a way that would be more fitting with the desires that you have and what we see in your word. Please be with the ones that have been mentioned tonight who are struggling with physical illnesses. We're thankful for Ms. Teresa to be back home after the hospital. Please continue to be with her and help her grow in strength. And be with Mr. Gary as he tends to her needs, and be with both of them and help us to do all we can to encourage and strengthen them. Be with all the ones that are struggling spiritually, ones that may keep things to themselves and don't feel quite comfortable talking about it. Please allow us to say something that may encourage them and something may give them the courage to speak up to the needs that they may have. We ask that you would help us to do all that we can to glorify you. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.